General Manager of Diesel Engine Sales Company of St. Augustine, Florida. I have an interesting story which we will show you on this film, the name being Bold Venture, because it was a bold venture when we started 12 years ago to produce and mass produce these shrimp trawlers that we have launched over 820 up to this date. As a matter of fact, this morning we are launching number 821. The mass production of these trawlers was only done through the assistance and the help of naval architects, which we employed here several years ago. As a matter of fact, I recently attended a meeting in Rome, Italy last month, and at this particular meeting, there were 40 nations represented, and I delivered a paper on the mass production and design of shrimp trawlers. I would like to quote an article here from Professor Lewis pertaining to my paper. According to Professor Lewis, the lighter the boat on a given length has a better sea behavior and less stresses in the seaway, and that is the reason why diesel engine sails boats are preferred over steel hulls. I would also like to present at this time and also mention the fact that we prepared this manual here, which is called the Diesel Engine Sails Trawler Handbook. Every one of our customers is presented with one of these handbooks so that they can operate the boat much safer and take care of it in the maintenance. Here's the exact model of our 67-foot shrimp trawler. I'll mention a few of the highlights. And here's the rigging, the pilot house, and here's the two outrigger booms. And this is what we call the twin rig, so we can operate two individual shrimp trawls and improve the efficiency of the trawling. Now I would like to present the end product. This is a shellfish known as the shrimp. Over 200 million pounds of shrimp are caught each year. These boats have an ice capacity of 40 tons and carry enough fuel so they can operate in the Gulf of Mexico for a period of 50 to 60 days. Now many of our boats are operating in the Caribbean Sea and off the coast of South America. And now I will take you on a conducted tour of our yard and show you how we mass produce shrimp trawlers here at Diesel Engine Sales, St. Augustine, Florida.
This is the beginning of the bold venture, the backbone of a trawler that will sail to the far reaches of the sea in the classic tradition of wooden ships and iron men. It is fitting that traditions are built by master craftsmen like these shipwrights who have been at their trade for many years, the trade of fashioning the keel of a vessel, capable of braving the broad reaches of the open ocean. More, a vessel that can meet and master the elements and bring home a valuable cargo. Craftsmen using the tools of modern civilization and the knowledge of the ages to produce the very finest shrimp trawler. A very carefully selected oak limb is cured in salt water for months before going into the vessel as a stern knee. In order to take maximum advantage of the natural strength of the knee is hand-trimmed so that the desired bend conforms to the natural angle of the trunk and limb. The final fitting must be done by hand, and here again, the use of specialists shows a saving in time. These two men work as a team, each with his own special task to perform. The use of templates and prepared forms is a great aid in speeding the various jobs. Inasmuch as all parts are cut to a standard on each boat, there is no need to correct or rearrange any part of the construction. This close tolerance, jointing, and similar methods of bolting and fastening result in a backbone. A backbone that is virtually one single piece. Now, the keel, a single piece of pine or Douglas fir with the stem, shaft log, and transom knee attached. painted with a wood preservative, becomes a moving assembly on the line. A special steam cabinet heats the solid oak ribs for 1.5 hours under a pressure of 10 pounds per square inch. A single rib at a time is taken from the cabinet and bent while still hot. They form, increasing the angle of bend step by step. A batten is nailed to the rib temporarily to hold it in the desired shape while it cools and regains its original hardness. This system of bending a vessel's ribs has its foundation in antiquity. None of the strength inherent in the wood is lost in the process, yet the exact shape needed can be obtained without jointing a single member. While two men bend the oak ribs, four men set them in place and nail them to batten. Now that the framing is completed, the molds are removed and returned to their position on the line, ready for the next vessel. The Bold Venture now begins to take on her classic form. This is the strongly constructed section growing from her backbone that will hold the vessel together in the mountainous sea she must encounter eventually. The boat at this stage looks like the skeleton of one of the sea's creatures, for it is a fact that nature has provided her children with structural strength in their bodies to fit their environment. Men, therefore, have copied nature's construction design and fashioned by hand a creature of their own, suited for this often hostile environment. The skeleton of the Bold Venture is carefully put together, fitted and bolted in a manner that almost makes her grow into a living form. These men are working deep in the rib cage, setting in the bed for the engine, the heart that will drive the vessel. Solid 10x10 pine timbers, mountings for the large diesel. In any assembly line, it is vital that all parts be kept in stock in quantities that will ensure against the possibility of a work stoppage. The diesel engine sales stock rooms are so arranged that the thousands of parts going into each vessel are stored in order of demand. Consequently, the orderly management of the supply department is absolutely imperative. Each part, nail, bolt, screw, the smallest and the largest, is noted when issued and charged against a particular boat. Careful purchasing enables the company to pass on savings to the customer. Galvanized nails of three different types and many different sizes are used. At left, anchor fast and standard. At right, the screw-type nail. The Bold Venture has now progressed to the decking stage. The deck is sanded, caulked, and tarred. The ribs extend above the deck line to form the vessel's bulwark, tying it directly into the keel. This type of trawler is designed with the deckhouse well forward for ample working space. It contains the crew quarters as well as the pilot house. While the deckhouse is being constructed above, the planking of the sides is going on below. All the planking above the waterline is of long length, seasoned Douglas fir, while that below the waterline is cypress. Cypress, called the wood eternal because of its remarkable long life, has become increasingly rare in recent years. Yet great pains are taken not only to secure this special wood, but to see that only the select pieces available are properly fitted in. The planking is so expertly filed in that only the butts and garboard seams are caught. The final step in this operation is the fitting of the shutter board. Since the planking is done simultaneously from gunwale down and the keel up, the width of the shutter board varies from inch to inch. The cutting and fitting of the shutter board is the job of the master planker. Countersinking of exposed fastenings is important. This ensures protection from electrolysis, which will dissolve nearly all metals over a period of time. Driving the fastenings into the planks also serves to set them more firmly, as the normal swelling of the wood will lock them in. Only four kinds of wood are used throughout the entire construction of a diesel engine sails trawler: yellow pine, Douglas fir, white oak, and cypress. Nowhere inside or out is quality sacrificed for the sake of speed or cost. The sanding of a vessel this size is no small task. Each square inch of every surface must be thoroughly sanded before painting. Right behind the standing crew come the painters. This man is spraying a metallic base anti-fouling paint into each nail hole. This, so no wood is left exposed to the possible invasion of chipworms. After spraying each nail hole below the waterline, it is then filled with cement. This further prevents worm damage around the fastening. All coats of paint are brushed on because it is felt that this method, though more time-consuming, provides a thicker and more evenly spread coating. Primer coats both above and below the waterline are applied slowly and carefully. Filling of the above waterline nail holes comes after the primer coat because they are easier to find at that time. The Diesel Engine Sales Company is more than a boat building yard. It is a self-contained factory that is dependent only upon itself for the quality of all of the many critical areas of boat building. The finishing of these supplies must be done to the satisfaction of the corporation because all possible departments are under the same organizational roof. This modern, completely equipped machine shop employing the latest equipment fits into the corporation plan. Shafts, propellers, and their companion hardware comes from the machine shop on schedule. This tubing will go into a special cooling system on the bottom of the trawler. Called a keel cooler, the system works much the same as the radiator in your automobile. It is a sealed recirculating system employing fresh water. The water circulates through a simple system of coils bolted to the bottom of the boat, where it is cooled by the sea. The bronze propeller is fastened to a Tobin bronze shaft, used because of its high resistance to bending and twisting. Bronze, a metal that is only slightly subject to the damaging effects of salt water, is also particularly useful in propellers. A mechanic and helper install the shaft, propeller, rudder, stern bearing, stuffing box, keel cooler, and other underwater fittings. The final step before launching is the attaching of zinc plates to the underwater metal surface. These plates prevent damage by electrolysis because they are more subject to this action than the bronze. Therefore, the electrolysis works on the zinc alone. The Bold Venture is now ready for launching, but she is still a long way from sea ready. The engine, superstructure, fuel tank, and electronic gear are waiting at dockside down the line, along with hundreds of other details of fitting out. As with all other vessels of Diesel Engine Sales, she will actually be launched twice. The first time, she will be taken to a special fitting out dock. Then after a shakedown cruise, she will return to the line for one last inspection before delivery to her owner. Feet of seaworthiness. The classic design of the hull originates with the Greek sponge fishing boat. She is built with an abnormally high bow and transom stern, a design that gives her a low prismatic coefficient and a good head sea performance, but nevertheless keeps the working areas relatively dry in rough weather. All boats here are on the assembly line. These are the fitting out docks. Notice how the boats settle close to their natural water line, as each is fitted in turn with the heavy running and fishing gear. The 6,000-gallon capacity welded steel fuel tank will allow the trawler to work 50 to 60 days at sea without refueling. And these are the diesel engines they will fuel. Owners choose their own make and horsepower. The engines are either Caterpillar or General Motors, or any other make of engine the customer may desire, of horsepower ranging between 150 and 250. Fuel costs are always an important factor in shrimp fishing. DESCO trawlers will cruise at 10 knots with ample power to pull two 45-foot trawls at about 3 knots an hour. In boat building, more so than in most businesses, there is no substitute for know-how. These power plants are rugged, heavy-duty engines with power takeoff for operating winches and other hauling gear, designed for 24-hour-a-day operation weeks at a time. This combination of trawler and engine is the result of years of design and engineering. While the installation of the engine and fuel tanks is underway, welders in the nearby welding department are busy fabricating the masts, booms, and mufflers. It is here that the most radical change in fishing gear of recent years gets its birth, the double rig. The double rig uses two towing booms fastened to the same mast instead of the conventional one. This is the double rig trawl to be installed on the Bold Venture. The booms on either side of the mast carry outside reinforcing. This is to prevent failure under the stresses of fishing in abnormally heavy weather. Masts and booms are assembled ashore, even to the extent of rigging the hemp line. This means of installation makes it possible to expedite the fitting out. The vertical rigging can be easily reached at all times during construction. Aligning the 2,000-pound assembly with the already installed mast plate is gently handled by the crane operator with the guidance of the rigging assistant. Final adjustments are made by hand through the use of hemp rigging. A final weld makes a single unit of the two sections. Last comes the heavy-duty winches that will provide the muscle to haul the two 45-foot nets. The parting touch of the craftsman, the fashioning of the ship's wheels, traditionally a part of the vessel that has a very personal meaning to the sailor. Fine wood, carefully fitted in an intricate pattern. This wheel is attached to an automatic pilot, just part of the electronic aid to the modern fisherman. This is the depth recorder, often called a fish finder because of its help in locating productive ground. The Bold Venture has been hauled out of the water after the installation of the electronic equipment for a final check run on the hull and rigging above and below the waterline. Now the dock lines are coiled and stowed, the engine started, and the chocks knocked away. Propeller turning even before she hits the water. The Bold Venture is ready to be turned over to her new owner. Chalk up number 820. This is truly a remarkable record for a young company. 820 boats over a period of 13 years for an amazing average of more than a boat a week. Day of delivery. The customer takes over from the builder, Mr. L.C. Ringhaver, president and general manager of Diesel Engine Sales, who presents him with the DESCO handbook. This manual describes in detail all the intricate installations aboard the Bold Venture, as well as methods for maintenance and operation. Everything is covered, from engine serial numbers, parts, specifications, to procedures for docking in foreign ports. And now to sea and her new home. So completely outfitted is the Bold Venture that when she puts out, the crew can actually fish on the way home and begin the commercial career of the vessel. This is an ultra-modern boat in all aspects of construction and rigging. Yet, she is a blend of hundreds of years of knowledge gained by seafaring men. It is appropriate that the design of this particular craft had its beginning in the heart of St. Augustine, Florida, our nation's oldest city. She goes to sea past the skyline of the ancient city founded nearly 400 years ago by men who came across the Atlantic to discover a new world. Direct descendants of these men had a hand in the construction of the Bold Venture. After arrival at her new port, the Bold Venture's crew begins the job of rigging new nets and running gear to make her sea-ready for long trips into the Gulf of Mexico or South American waters. Stout webs of linen mesh with floats of plastic or cork in bright colors to mark them out are carefully placed to prevent fouling when fed overside. An almost solid blanket of manila fibers protects the edge of the net that comes in contact with the bottom during the drag. These men know their business. This art of sailing to the far reaches of the seven seas in search of food for the world's dinner table. The kind of boat to use, the net, and the almost constant battle with the elements. The wooden paravanes that keep the net's mouth wide during the drag go overside. The net itself will follow. Then begins the long process of the slow and patient drag. A rewarding life, this probing of the ocean's depth. Harvest of the sea, delicious, freshly caught shrimp form the menu appropriately enough for the annual open house celebration at the Diesel Engine Sales Yard. And you might expect it. Even then, they are prepared in a new and different manner. Barbecues, no less. Hands that fashion the boats to catch these shrimp are now turned to the delightful task of slowly roasting these succulent children of the sea. Slowly and patiently done to a golden turn. Workmen who take such care in the building of a shrimp trawler can certainly be relied upon to make the most of her product. Huge mounds of green oak wood supply the bed of coals for the cooking fire. Master chef at the annual affair is one of St. Augustine's most prominent surgeons, Dr. Herbert E. White. The sauce concocted by the good doctor is reputed to be a jealously guarded secret, passed down from the town's earliest family. It is said that the recipe came to Dr. White in payment for the delivery of a new citizen. Whether this is true or not has never been admitted, but no one argues about the delectable flavor of this mysterious concoction. This, then, is the story of the birth of a boat designed to do a better job, and of the men who build them, craftsmen in every sense. This is the man who started DESCO, L.C. Ringhaver. And these are the people who come each year to enjoy his hospitality and see the results of his handiwork, customers, dignitaries, and employees alike. Why don't you try your favorite shrimp recipe today?